make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
We are one body, one planet, one church.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Praise to the Lord.
Lord, the Lord's name be praised.
Thank you.
of his hand. Oh, that today we would hearken to his voice.
Well, good morning and welcome to church.
Good morning.
And it looks like we even have some sunshine out there all of a sudden. Welcome. I'm doing my own Bible readings this morning because I forgot to ask someone. So if you're interested in doing these biblical readings of the morning, let me know. And I'll keep a mental note and that'll help me remember to ask somebody. Our readings today, as they have been for the entire time that I've been with you this summer and now in the fall, it seems like, heading into winter, have been from Genesis and Romans. So listen for the word of the Lord from Genesis chapter 15, verses 1 through 6. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Fear not, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what wilt thou give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, Behold, thou hast given me no offspring, and a slave born in my house will be my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, This man shall not be your heir. Your own son shall be your heir. And he brought him outside and said, Look toward heaven and number the stars if you are able to number them. Then he said to him, So shall your descendants be. And Abram believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. And the second reading is from Book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 18 through 26. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of him who subjected it in hope. Because the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and obtain the glorious liberty of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in travail together until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with sighs too deep for words.
Preach on
the letter of Paul today. I'm not. I'm sorry. I never know what I'm going to preach on until at least a couple days beforehand. I try to make promises and fulfill them. Sometimes I do, and sometimes I don't. So if you wanted to hear me talk about the creation groaning in travail, that wonderful passage from Paul, Romans 8, one of the most profound passages in all of Scripture, well, another day. Today we're focusing on the Lord taking Abraham out under the desert sky at night and telling Abraham to look up at the sky and look at the stars above and promise him, Abraham, so many shall your descendants be. And Abraham believed the Lord. There's that word again. Abraham believed the Lord. Abraham had faith in what the Lord said. Abraham trusted what the Lord was telling him. See how all those words mean something similar. Abraham believed the Lord. He had faith in the Lord's promise. He hoped that the Lord's promise would come true. So, however you want to put it, this act set our whole civilization into motion. In fact, several civilizations got set in motion by this act of faith. Abraham believed the promise of God, took God at his word, you might say, and the rest is history. The amazing history of Judaism, of Christianity, and of Islam. History of three religions, the history of many peoples, and most recently, here and now, the American people, namely us. And as we prepare, for a general election, it's only 2 weeks away, it's just two more weeks, folks. We've survived it up to this point. It's just two more weeks and 2 days. What do we believe? What holds us together as a people? That is my question for the day. What is our common faith? What are our common beliefs? What beliefs, what faith, what hope holds 350 million Americans together? And I suggest there is a bit of an answer there in our readings for today and in what a president-elect said on a bitter cold morning in January of 1961. January 20th, 1961 was a great day for New England, for two New Englanders got the most important speaking parts. The President, John F. Kennedy, of course, the youngest president-elect in history, and the aging poet Robert Frost was also called upon to compose a new poem for the occasion and read it aloud. More on Robert Frost some other time. For this morning, I want to take a look at just the first two paragraphs of John F. Kennedy's great inaugural address. And let us see if we could find there a clue about our common faith as Americans, and our common faith as sons and daughters of Abraham. We observe today not a victory of party, but a celebration of freedom, began the young president, symbolizing an end as well as a beginning, signifying renewal as well as change. For I have sworn before you and Almighty God the same solemn oath our forebears prescribed nearly a century and three quarters ago. Now, this first paragraph tells us that what we Americans believe in above all else is freedom. Freedom is what we fight for, it's what we fight over, it's what we fight about. And what we celebrate in free elections and the peaceful transfer of power. Thus, the inauguration of a president is a celebration of freedom. An inauguration of a president is also a celebration of human rights. For as President Kennedy went on to say in the next paragraph, the same revolutionary beliefs for which our forebears fought are still at issue around the globe. The belief that the rights of man come not from the generosity of the state, but from the hand of God. We dare not forget today that we are the heirs of that first revolution. So what are the revolutionary beliefs for which our forebears fought? Well, the president answered his own question. Our ancestors fought for the belief that the rights of man come not from the generosity of the state, but from the hand of God. That is our revolutionary belief, that rights, and all good things for that matter, come from the hand of God. This is the belief that kicked our civilization into being. The promise to Abraham came from the hand of God. And our revolutionary ancestors in the American Revolution and the Reformation all believed that all things worthwhile come from God. This God dependence is very important. The purpose of government is to protect God-given rights, which come not from the generosity of the state, but from the hand of God. We rebelled against a king, George III, because we considered him tyrannical. Upon setting up our own government, the founders well understood that tyranny could come as well from a mob as it could from a king. And just a few short years later, after we ratified our own constitution, actually less than a year later, the French Revolution showed how horribly a mob in charge of a government and an army could act. As a revolution in France endorsing the rights of man ended up trampling on them in worse fashion than their king ever did. After the series of meetings that produced our Constitution, so the story goes, an old lady asked Benjamin Franklin what the great legislators had come up with. "What have we got?" she asked. "What have you labored for? You've been there 3 days. What have we got?" Benjamin. Not Lincoln, Benjamin Franklin replied, "A republic, madam, if we can keep it." If we can keep it. Keeping a republic. If you're keeping a republic and things go wrong, you can't blame the king. The king's gone. It's only ourselves we can blame if things go wrong. So keeping a republic requires an Abrahamic act of faith, of hope, of belief, of charity, of a belief in God and a belief in one another. Keeping a republic requires compromise, a willingness to live and let live, and a willingness to recognize the limits of our own wisdom. Keeping a republic or any self-governing organization requires belief, in short, in the spirit of liberty, a belief that the Holy Spirit is indeed a spirit of liberty. That phrase, spirit of liberty, or title, comes from a speech given by one of the greatest judges in America, one of the greatest American judges who ever lived, who never made it to the Supreme Court. But he was a great judge in New York. His name was Judge Learned Hand. How do you get a name like that? Name your child Learned? How would you like to have that moniker on you when you arrive in kindergarten? Hello there, Learned. How learned are you? God, imagine the taunts this poor man got from his schoolmates. Well, anyhow, during World War II, I forget the occasion, he gave a speech which is known as the Spirit of Liberty speech. Here it is. Just a part of it. Don't worry, not the whole thing. What then is the spirit of liberty? I cannot define it. I can only tell you my own faith. The spirit of liberty is the spirit which is not too sure that it is right. The spirit of liberty is the spirit which seeks to understand the mind of other men and women. The spirit of liberty is the spirit which weighs their interests alongside its own without bias. The spirit of liberty remembers that not even a sparrow falls to earth unheeded. The spirit of liberty is the spirit of him who near 2,000 years ago taught mankind that lesson it has never learned, but never quite forgotten, that there may be a kingdom where the least shall be heard and considered side by side with the greatest. This spirit, of course, as the Bible tells us, was with God in the beginning, was with Abraham when God took him out under the desert stars and promised him that his descendants would be as numberless as the stars above. This spirit was with Moses when God gave him the law. This spirit was with the prophets who foretold the coming of the wonderful Counselor, the Prince of Peace, Jesus our Lord. This spirit of liberty, of belief in human rights, was with the people who founded our country and have kept it going and have brought us here this morning. So may this spirit be with us in these last 2 weeks before the election and continue to be with us in all the months ahead. Amen.
Thank you.
gifts redound to your glory, and strengthen us and strengthen this community so that your Spirit may work through this church and this congregation, through this town and into the wider world. Through the Spirit of Christ Jesus. Amen.